Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be here in your house to worship you. How wonderful it is to know that you are a God who makes and keeps promises. You have promised us so much if only we will keep your laws and your ways. And when you made your promises to your people, you knew we would sin and break our word and our promises to you. But instead of throwing us away as promise breakers unworthy of your grace and love, you sent your only Son to die and shed his blood for us so that we might receive the glory of all you have promised us if we only accept him as our Savior. Even in that, we have great troubles. Even in that, we have failed you. We are selfish and small-minded, and we want our own way, even when we see the failure and destructions of others before us who have followed their own way instead of surrendering and following you. You are the great I Am, the living law, the living word. And one day, everyone will come to know that fact. Thank you for choosing us from the beginning of time to be your people. Help us to grow and to understand, to spread the love you have for us to all around us by telling everyone how to be saved through Jesus Christ our Lord. Open our minds today and our hearts. Help us to be all that you desire us to be. Lead us in your ways, for it is in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Our hymn this morning, He Leadeth Me.
Thank you.
Our responsive reading this morning is Psalms 3, 6 through 8. Arise, O Lord, and bless your people. For I am not afraid of the tens of thousands who have taken positions against me on all sides.
Victory belongs to the Lord.
Amen. And bless the reading of God's word. Now we have a treat from our worship team, our young people coming forward now to sing We Believe. Good job, guys. All right. Our memory verse this week Now, do you know it without us putting it up on the board?
Nope.
What's our memory verse this week? Romans 3:23. This is our last week for this one. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's something we should always remember, because we're never better than anybody else, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we never put ourselves above someone else. We never make ourselves more important than someone else, because for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Good morning. Good to see all of you this morning. Good to see all of you that are watching from home. It's just good to be here. It was dry at my house this morning, but we wound up in the rain over here. But it's good to see all of you. It's good to have a lot of our kids here this morning, and some of them are off. We still have some people that are out ill, and so we'll keep them in prayer when we get to that portion. But it's good to have all of you that are watching us as well. Again, Bible study Wednesday, and then we're doing counseling. I'm here to do counseling, and I've got some time slots available. So give me a call out here at 967-3628. That's 814-967-3628. I think we've got that number up here, so you can pick it up. Where is that number? There it is. 967, or you can write me P.O. Box 41, Titusville. So this week, we got a lot of stuff going on. That's going on this week. Wednesday's for our teen program, and they're going to get ready for Sunday. What's Sunday going to be?
Sleepover.
What's going on Sunday?
Sleepover.
Oh, the kids don't have school Monday, and you're going to... Okay, so they're going to have a lock-in here. And sleepover Sunday. What else is going on Sunday?
Not a Halloween party.
Not a Halloween party is going on. Right. That's great. Somebody said they ate all of their Halloween candy already, so they're really, really anxious to have the not a Halloween party next Sunday. And potluck is next Sunday. We'll have lots of stuff. We might even have a birthday party or two going on at the same time. So we're having lots of things going on, and I just want to make sure. But we've got all kinds of stuff going on here at the church, and if you want to help us contribute something to the kids or the program, we thank the people that have done that. But if you want to help, you can either send us a check at P.O. Box 41 to Community Bible Church, or you can go to our NoFundMe page. At Community Bible Church, and you can go to NoFundMe, and then at NoFundMe you can find what it's religious services, and in there in the box you can type Reverend Babcock or Rudolph Babcock in there, and it'll pull. We're the only one up, we're only one there, and our NoFundMe or GoFundMe thing, it hasn't grown very much, and we're trying to hope that grows into something that'll be our Christmas money. And don't tell the kids, but you know, I'm dependent on something there for Christmas, so we can keep that a secret, right, from the kids. But anyway, and all of that's coming up here pretty soon. So anything else going on that I need? I know that the fall's coming. I got to get out here and work. We finally got the heat, the furnace fixed. Boy, what a, you know, since I'm going into the blessing thing and that, came out here and mowed the grass, hopefully, maybe for the last time Friday, where we had a sunny day. But I've got all kinds of flower beds now that I got to dig up, and bulbs to dig up, and the kids want, that's something else. I'll put that on somebody's list right now, but I need tongue depressors or a bunch, because the kids said they want to plant bulbs, write their names. Every fall, we get the kids write their names with a permanent marker on a tongue depressor, and then they plant bulbs by their marker and wait to see what comes up in the spring. So they want to do that again this year. So I got to get the flower beds ready for that. And on Friday I was here for the furnace, and I'm going to lead that with a praise, because It wasn't appraised last week. A week and a half ago, I had somebody come out from the company who put the furnace in. It's a brand new furnace, only 3 years old, and he came up and out, and he said, "Oh, it needed this part and it needed that part." And I said, "Okay, well, we got a 10-year warranty on parts. I don't care about the parts. Put the parts in." But to put the new parts in, boy, was that like almost $1,200 and $1,100 and something to put a couple parts. And I'm saying, "Wow, how long is that going to take? Hey, you know, am I going to be here for a year waiting for that to get done?" And I said, "No, it's about an hour." I said, "You charge that much an hour for labor?" And he said, "Well, because the parts are all under warranty." So anyway, I screamed bloody murder to everybody. Train and Home Depot, where we bought the unit, because it just didn't seem right. And so finally, I got a Train expert and the manager of the company that sold us the unit to come out here, and he looked and he attacked the problem from the other direction, and it found out that all we needed to do was clean the jets or the gas burners. They just needed to be cleaned, boom, and everything turned back on. No parts, no nothing, and that's really appraised because we saved the church about $960 of money that would be tough for us to grab at this point. But anyway, so I think that's really appraised. And the heat came on this morning. It came on time, and it's working really well. That's really praise, and I'm really, really thankful for that. Didn't need any parts. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working miracles and wonderful things in your life. I mean, that's a... Pardon it? Next Sunday is communion, yes. So, remember all of that. We'll have communion next Sunday. Yes. Okay, all right. So, okay. Anyone else this morning? Mike, how's your have a praise? How's your mom's got her boot off, and she didn't fall down again. Yeah, and my mom got out of her crutches too a while back, and she didn't fall down again either. Praise the Lord. So we've got lots of answered prayer. Sue's here. That's an answer to last week's prayer, and. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working miracles and wonderful things in your lives.
I just praise the Lord that every week I feel better.
every week, yeah, that you feel better, look stronger, and that's great. Anyone else this morning have a praise? Yes, Julia.
My dad's butt isn't getting worse, but it's not getting better.
Say that again.
My dad's butt's not getting worse.
Is it getting worse or not getting worse? It's not getting worse. Okay. We've been praying for Julia's dad's foot, and it's not getting worse. She said it's not getting better yet, but it's not getting worse. So we thank the Lord for that as well. Anyone else this morning have a praise and prayer request? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the things that you do for us. We thank you for our church, and we thank you for all of these wonderful dynamic kids that we have. We just thank you so much for those that are here and those that aren't. And we thank you for their dedication to serve you and the growth that we've seen in them and in their lives. And we just ask you to continue to keep your hand upon them as they try to survive in a world that isn't favorable to you. But we ask you to give them the strength to continue to find that the right way and the right path is through you. help them be what they need to be to their friends, their families, and all around, to live the example that they need to live to bring other people. And we thank you so much that they keep inviting their friends and to come to church and to youth group and all the different things that we have going on here at the church. We ask you to be with their parents as well and watch over them and all of their teachers and everybody who provides leadership for them. Keep them safe. We ask you to be with this country, and we ask you to continue to guide this country along the right path so we can continue to be the Christian nation we were intended to be and that we promised to be from the very beginning. Sometimes we, Lord, want to forget the promises of our founding fathers, of the pilgrims that you saved and provided food for, and those that all through many wars have put their life on the line and prayed for guidance, for strength, for the ability to serve in foxholes and all kinds of things that have gone on. We just thank you for watching over us and helping us to be the country that we need to be. Help us to continue to be that. Be with all of those who serve this country and the military and serve at home and in faraway places. We ask you to be with the families of those who have lost their loved ones, especially the four that were just lost in Africa and in the training mission in Afghanistan. Be with them and their families as well. Be with all of those who govern this country, our president, our congressmen, and senators, and all of the people that are guiding this country, that they will do the right thing and lead this country in a proper way. We ask you to be with all of our firemen and police officers and doctors and nurses and everyone that puts on a uniform to serve one another. Be with them as well this morning. Guide this church and help us to be the people that we need to be, to reach into the community, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to all around us. You could come at any moment. You could send your son. We could hear his voice in the next instant calling for us like a thief in the night out of the clouds on his way here to gather us. There's nothing. Nothing holding him back from doing that. So help us be what we need to do to gather all of our family and our loved ones, because we need to know that when we leave this earth, it's going to be very difficult for those who are left behind. So put a burden on our hearts for lost souls. Put a burden on this church to reach out and be the beacon that it needs to be all around us. We ask you to we thank you for all the many blessings that you have bestowed upon this church, the healing of nearly everyone in here in all forms and manners. And we ask you to continue to be with Julia's dad with his foot and the diabetes. And we ask you now that his foot has stopped getting worse to actually start turning that any other way. We ask you to be with the Schaefer family and all the things that are going on with them as well. We ask you to be with this church as we go through all the different and difficult and times that are ahead of us as well. And we ask all these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray. Amen. Fill my cup, Lord. we're still making it through the book of Ezra. This morning we're going to do chapters 7 and 8 of Ezra. It's a very, very interesting story, and one I think that almost nobody knows, but it's a wonderful story. And so chapter 7 and 8 of Ezra, if you have your Bibles, we're just going to do both of the verses. I'm going to skip through some of the names because even I can get tongue-tied at that. So beginning in verse 1, chapter 7. After these things, during the reign of King Artaxerxes of Persia, Ezra left Babylon. Ezra was, and I'm going to skip Ezra's very distinguished and direct lineage right down to Phinehas, who was the son of Eleazar, who was the son of Aaron, the first priest. As a scribe, Ezra was an expert in Moses' teaching, which the Lord God of Israel had given. The king gave Ezra everything he requested because the Lord, his God, was guiding him. Some Israelites, including priests, Levites, singers, gatekeepers, and temple servants, went to Jerusalem in Artaxerxes' seventh year as king. Now jump down to verse 10. Ezra was determined to study the Lord's teaching, live by them, and teach their rules and regulations in Israel. This is a copy of the letter that King Artaxerxes gave Ezra, the priest and scribe, a man with a thorough knowledge of the Lord's commands and laws for Israel. From Artaxerxes, this is his letter, from Artaxerxes, king of kings, to Ezra the priest, a scribe for the teaching of the God of heaven, I wish you peace and prosperity. I have issued a decree that any Israelites who are in my kingdom and want to go with you to Jerusalem may go. This also includes the priests and Levites. Remember, there had been a previous group of about 50,000 that went before, and now Artaxerxes has given Ezra. I, the king, and my seven advisors are sending you to evaluate the situation in Judah and Jerusalem on the basis of your God's teachings, which you hold in your hands. Also, you must take the silver and gold that the king and his advisors willingly contributed to the God of Israel, the God whose temple is in Jerusalem. This is another set batch of gold and silver that being sent. Take any silver and gold that you find in the whole province of Babylon where you when you take the gifts contributed by the people and the priests. They willingly contributed these gifts for the temple of their God in Jerusalem. You must use this money to buy bulls, rams, lambs, grain, and wine to offer on the altar of the temple of your God in Jerusalem. You and your relatives may do whatever you think is right with the rest of the silver and gold. However, what you do must conform to the will of your God. The utensils that have been given to you so that they can be used in your God's temple must all be presented to the God of Jerusalem. You may use the king's treasury to pay for anything else that you must provide for your God's temple. I, King Artaxerxes, Lord in the treasury in the province of the Lord. King Artaxerxes, order all the treasuries in the province west of the Euphrates River to do exactly what Ezra the priest, a scribe for the teaching of the God of heaven, asked you to do. You may give him up to, listen to this, 7,500 pounds of silver. That would be a lot today. 100 measures of wheat, 600 gallons of wine, 600 gallons of olive oil, and as such salt as he needs. Whatever the God of heaven has commanded must be carried out in detail for the temple of the God of heaven. Why should God become angry with the king's empire and his sons? Furthermore, we are notifying you that you are forbidden to make any priest, Levite, singer, gatekeeper, servant, or worker in the temple of this God pay any taxes, fees, or tolls. You, Ezra, using your God's wisdom, the teachings you hold in your hands, will appoint judges and administrators for all the people who know your God's teaching and live in the province west of the Euphrates River. In addition, you will teach anyone who doesn't know the teachings. Whoever will not strictly follow your God's teachings and a king's orders should be promptly exiled. have his goods confiscated, be in prison, or be sentenced to death. I, Ezra said, thanks be to the Lord God of our ancestors. He put this into the king's mind to make the Lord's temple in Jerusalem beautiful. He made the king and his advisors and all the king's powerful officials treat me kindly. I was encouraged because the Lord my God was guiding me. So I gathered leaders in Israel to go with me. Now in verse 8, we learn that the next several verses list the families who left Babylon with me during the reign of King Artaxerxes. So we can skip over all of those names because they really come into existence if you're Jewish. But for our purposes today, not. And jumping down to verse 15, I had this group gathered by the river that flows by Ahava, and we camped there for 3 days. I noticed lay people and priests there, but I didn't find any Levites. Then I sent for Ezra and 8 more who were leading men, and for Jorib and Eliathan, who were wise. I sent them to Edo, the leader in Casiphia. I told them to tell Edo and his relatives, the temple servants in Casiphia, that they should bring us men who can serve in our God's temple. God was guiding us. So Edo and his relatives brought us someone competent, Sarabiah, who was also a direct descendant of Levi in Israel. They brought us temple servants who were descendants from the temple servants whom David and his officials had appointed to work for the Levites. These were all listed by name. Then I announced a fast there at the Ahava River, so that we might humble ourselves in the presence of God to ask him for a safe journey for ourselves, for our little ones, and for all our goods. Now, this is one of the parts I like the most. And I was ashamed to ask the king for an armed escort with cavalry to help us against an enemy attack on the way. We had already told the king, our God works things out for the good of everyone who dedicates his life to serve him. But his power and his anger oppose everyone who abandons him. So we fasted and asked our God for a safe journey. And guess what happened? God answered our prayers. They said, I weighed the contributions. He selected 12 leaders, and then they weighed the contributions for them to guard, about 24 tons of silver. Can you imagine? 24 tons of silver they wind up with. 100 silver utensils weighing 150 pounds apiece. 750 pounds of gold. Wouldn't you like to have just a piece of that today? 20 gold bowls weighing 18 pounds apiece, and 2 utensils of fine polished bronze that were as precious as gold. I told them, you and the utensils are holy to the Lord. The silver and gold are free will offerings. See, we don't want to do that. We want to talk about tithes. But here we say, I told them, you and the utensils are holy to the Lord. The silver and the gold are free will offerings to the Lord God of your ancestors. Guard them carefully. In Jerusalem, inside the storerooms of the Lord's temple, weigh these items. Do this in front of the chief priests, Levites, and the leaders of Israel's families. So the priests and the Levites took charge of the silver, the gold, and the utensils. They were responsible for bringing these items to the temple of our God in Jerusalem. Then we left the Ahava River on the 12th day of the first month to go to Jerusalem. God was guiding us. And he rescued us from our enemies and from ambushes along the way. I can imagine everybody must have known that they had that much gold and silver, and their journey was wroth with ambushes. We reached Jerusalem and put the silver and the gold and the utensils in our God's temple. And then down to verse 35. The exiles who had come back from captivity sacrificed burnt offerings to the God of Israel, 12 bulls for all Israel, 96 rams, 77 lambs, and 12 male goats for an offering for sin. All of these animals were burnt offerings for the Lord. Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Who knows who those people are? Can you get a hands of anybody who knows who Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah is? Oh, I got one hand back there. All right. Who are these guys anyway? But Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah are their Jewish names. They were friends of Daniel. And almost everybody knows their story, except most people know Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah by their Babylonian names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And I'm sure you know about Daniel in the lion's den, and Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah in the fiery furnace. I like using their Jewish names. Now, don't let anyone tell you that these are just kids' fairy tales. They are not. Just like Joseph, who went to Egypt and prepared the way for his family and the rest of the Jews to come, Daniel and his three friends set the ground rules by which the Persian Empire revolved during that period of time, via, of course, the direction of God and their unquestionable belief and trust in God to guide them through anything. This failure to believe is the problem with the Jewish nation. It's why they're in captivity, and also it's our very own problem as well here today. Most of the time, the Jews and we belong right in the very same smelly group, giving only lip service to God. And occasionally God rises up saints to stand solely and completely on God without question and show the rest of us how it is done. The story of Joseph was considered a fairy tale until recently when his tomb and a multitude of the grain silos that he had built of that same period were all excavated. This is an amazing story, the one we're talking about here in Ezra, because it reaches way back into history in order to make any sense. We have to reach back to make sense of it. The story of Daniel in the lion's den, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, or Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, and Daniel's interpretation of dreams all spread around the empire of the Medes and the Persian. Remember that Cyrus took over the Babylonian Empire, and all of this began to happen, and its story spreads like wildfire all around the Medes and the Persian Empire and into the hands of their enemies. And because the Medes and the Persians could brag that they had those guys in their possession, the Persian Empire explodes in size and power and wealth. So they really became the Persian Empire's Goliath. This is why you see these very famous, very powerful Persian emperors granting to the Jews this benevolence. If it hadn't happened, they wouldn't have given these guys a nickel, let alone 750 pounds of gold. And because of that, they believed in the God of heaven. But they also believed in their gods as well. So did Persia disappear from the face of the earth? Who thinks Persia has disappeared from the face of the earth? Who thinks that it hasn't? It hasn't. No, Persia is now the country we know as Iran. And way back in Ezra's time, the Persians were favorable to the Jews, and today they want to destroy them. We can be assured that destruction of Israel will never happen. The Jews had gone into the Babylonian captivity because they continually turned to idolatry. Idolatry is when you worship something other than God. When you make it, whether it's money, football, certain music, when those things become more important than worshiping God, they become idols. Also, the Jews had disobeyed the Mosaic law, in that they had not allowed the land to lie fallow every 7th year. Moses had set up the law, and they were supposed to allow the land to lay fallow, nothing growing on it, to rest every 7th year. They probably did not think it was too important, and they thought they were sneaking one over on God. Boy, we do that all the time, don't we? We just think we can sneak one over on God. But God said, I'm going to put you out of the land for 70 years so that the land can catch up on the Sabbaths it has missed. If you look at this and do the math, it means that God had put up with this breaking of his law for 420 years. If you plug in the numbers, it becomes very interesting, because the Battle of Carchemish is in 605 BC. That's the destruction of the Jews by Nebuchadnezzar the first time. And this is the beginning of the 70 years of captivity. The Battle of Carchemish is when they begin to measure the 70 years. These years are ended by Cyrus in 536 BC, 70 years later. Now, add 420 years of disobedience to the end of God's patience in 605 BC, and we come up with a very, very interesting number, or interesting date. The date that we come up with, if we add that disobedience and the battle, is 1025 BC. So what happens in 1025 BC? It's a very, very interesting date. And it's a date in history. Do we know what it is? It's the date that David killed Goliath and Saul passed his anointing, or God passed his anointing from David, or from Saul on to David. By the way, the temple in Jerusalem, this temple that they're building, was destroyed again by the Romans in 70 AD. And in 66 AD, the Israelites rebelled against Rome and are destroyed. Christ was born, contrary to popular opinion, not on 0 BC, but on 4 BC. So if you do the math, Israel is destroyed again 70 years exactly after the birth of Jesus Christ. So somehow this 70 number keeps popping up. May be interesting. One of the things that's interesting to me is, just in case it might mean anything to anyone else, Israel was restored to the land in 1948. And if you add 70 years to that number, we come to the year 2018. The point I'm trying to make, and have been trying to make, is, I mean, I don't know if 2018 is going to be the year or not. I don't know if 2018 has any significance, but it could have. And that's my point, because this is what I've been trying to say, to tell everybody all this time. God does have a limit and a patience. And there comes a time when there is a definitive thing. The Jews actually do get carried off into captivity. The temple does get destroyed twice. The Jews do finally get carried off into Europe. They do come back to the land. The prophecies that God has said, and the idea that we can just, you know, do whatever we want to do because we can pull one over on God, finally comes to an end. I don't know. Does it come to an end next year? I don't know. It seems to me that we have entered for some time now into a similar period that the Jews were in. A short time ago, nearly everyone in the U.S. went to church and worshiped God. We know that God has commanded us to worship Him in many places all across the Bible. So I was talking to a young person last week, and we were talking about excuses to miss church. Does God give us an excuse to miss church when we have been instructed to come and worship Him? Even Jesus Christ went to temple every Sabbath and to Jerusalem every year for Passover. So where do we go to get this permission to miss church? Where do we go to get permission to stop worshiping God? Well, the truth is that God does not give us permission not to worship Him or His Son, Jesus Christ. He just doesn't allow it. And sometimes we wind up in the bad side of that. And the Jews have discovered this on way more than one occasion, at a terrible and horrible cost each time. A cost which I don't ever want to have to pay. A cost in which I don't want to see anyone I care about have to pay. But if we disobey God and continually disobey God and flaunt ourselves in God's nose, the period of captivity, horror, and pain becomes inevitable, meaning that it will happen. Believe me, it will happen. One of the reasons that I know it happens is look at this from Revelation 6:15 and 17. Then the kings of the earth, the important people, the generals, The rich, the powerful, and all the slaves and free people hid themselves in caves and among the rocks in the mountains. I think about all of this, you know, where we have the where we had Independence Day, the movie Independence Day, and a couple of other stuff. What were they doing? They were hiding themselves in the mountain. And they said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of the one who sits on the throne. In other words, all the tunnels and things that they were going to dig inside the mountains and under the mountains, and weren't going to protect them from anybody. They said, fall on us and hide us from the face of the one who sits on the throne and from the anger of the Lamb, that's Jesus Christ, because the frightening day of their anger has come, and who is able to endure it? This is so important. Jesus tells us this thing, tells us twice this, once in Luke and here in Revelation. There will come a day for you and me, just to as there was a day which came for the nation of Israel. Ezra is one of the most important but most neglected characters of the Bible. I do not believe many have ever heard a sermon on the book of Ezra. Have you ever heard this book taught before? Ezra was a lineal descendant of Phinehas, the grandson of Aaron. He belonged, therefore, to the priestly line. Had there been a temple in Jerusalem, he probably would have functioned as its high priest. Now, Ezra gathers a group of about 2,000 Jews and leads them to Jerusalem. The temple had been rebuilt so that there was a place for him to minister. He is also a very knowledgeable teacher of the Word of God. We will discover that Ezra is labeled a ready scribe again and again. Ezra 7:21 tells us that Ezra had a reputation. Now think about that word. This is one of the things that I keep talking about to kids and everybody around here, about their reputation. And it says in the Bible, one of the things that's important, that Ezra had a reputation down in Babylon, even with the king, as being scribe of the words of the Lord God. God's word and his promises continued to rule even during the time of captivity. And through it all, God managed to see to it Ezra develops and grows. Why? Well, way back a long time ago, God had promised Phinehas, because of his faithfulness in curbing marriages outside of with foreign women, because he ended that and had done that by God's direction, that he showed his faithfulness, and God promised that the priesthood will remain in his family forever. So even though they're in captivity, God has to raise up somebody from that line, and it's Ezra. So God must keep that promise, and he does. Ezra had prepared his heart for the day that he would return to his land. He knew it was coming because he had faith in God. So he prepared his heart and studied the law of Moses. Actually, the first five books of the Bible and the book of Joshua were the things that he had, which were in existence at that day. Ezra not only studied God's word, he also did what it said. Oh my. It is one thing to study God's word and another thing to do it. To actually bring God's word into our hearts and minds and live by them and do it. To walk that walk and talk that talk. Not some days or once in a while, but every minute of every day of our lives. And I know, here it is, I'm waiting for it. Now, preacher, you're really getting pretty far out there. I have a life, I want to live, I have dreams, things more important to do. I can't do all that all the time. Boring, what I hear. Not only can't I do that all the time, I don't want to do that all of that. I want to party, right? Isn't that what I hear? I want to party. I hear it from people, and that's what keeps them out of the churches. Then the next scene, if we're looking at a movie, and that the next scene that flashes before our eyes and flashes before my eyes is me visiting that person in her third or fourth sentence time to prison. The first or second time just somehow wasn't enough, I guess, to keep them from wanting to go back. I guess they party in prison. I don't know. And I asked, just like I asked the other day, which actually happened. I asked the other day, listen, And I want you guys to listen because this is real stuff, just like it was when the children of Israel were carried off in chains to a prison called Babylon. So I asked the other day, how was the party? I'm in jail talking to somebody there. And what I always hear is, always, every time, what I always hear is it wasn't worth it. I don't think that I've ever been in that situation where I've heard anything other than that. It wasn't worth it. Most often through a whole lot of tears. And this is what this book of the Bible is trying to teach us. That if we don't listen and we want to party instead, we'll discover, and I promise you that will happen, that at some point you will discover that it isn't worth it. And if we listen and obey God, he will raise us up just as he did Ezra. And God, will remember and keep his promises toward us. And the life, our life, will be much more wonderful than we could ever have imagined. When I was your age, when I was one of the young people, I was sitting right where you were. I never imagined this age. But I can tell you, the life I live is a wonderful life, being close to the Lord. I have never understood how being on our knees praying over the toilet or being in an ambulance racing to the emergency room before the overdose kills us was so much fun. Ezra's whole purpose was that he wanted God's people to know God's statutes and judgments. They weren't hearing them in Babylon. Ezra, and we're not hearing them around the community either. Ezra had a real witness in the Persian court. Because the king and his counselors made this offering to, and we know that they did because they made the offering to the God of Israel. Can you say that this story resembles your life? Have you made such an impact on others so that they believe? Because you are so dynamic in your life that they can't help but believe. Ezra made such an impact on these people who worshipped other gods so much so that they were compelled to give an offering to the God of Israel. When you live that kind of life, I promise you, you are at the party. The only real party. Ezra was given the king's decree. The decree reveals a tremendous reverence for God. Notice how it concludes. And whosoever will not do the law of thy God and the law of the king, let judgment be executed upon him, whether it be unto death or to banishment or to confiscation of goods or to imprisonment. Not only was the temple to be rebuilt, it was also to be made beautiful. Now Ezra calls for a fast and a great prayer meeting at the river of Ahava because he wanted to know God's will. And then we get to this part that I really love, where he said that he was ashamed. He was ashamed to ask the king for guards and people to help him. He said, you know, I went before the king and told him that the hand of our God was with us, and it was sufficient that he will be against our enemies and will guide us back to our land. Ezra looked at the delegation gathered by the river, ready to go on that long march. He looked at the families and the little ones. He looked at all the gold and silver and that he was responsible to get to the temple of Jerusalem, and he knew the dangers all along the way. The normal thing might have been to ask the king for a little help, for a few guards to ride along with them, right? And after all, that which the king and the Persian court had learned about the God of Israel, Ezra was too ashamed to ask for help. For mere mortals, even a king of mortals, as he and his, would trust in God. This is another thing I have had to learn over the years. Sometimes some of us become very eloquent about how we are trusting God and how wonderful he is. But when we get right down to the nitty-gritty, we don't really trust him. And we turn to mortals instead. Through the Bible, you'll read that God always hated when the nation of Israel turned to Egypt instead of to him. What was Ezra's alternative? He called a prayer meeting and a fast. He said, oh Lord, we just have to depend on you. You know, the Lord puts many of us in that position many, many times. And God did watch over them, and they arrived with all the gold and all their peoples safely at their destination. In verse 35:12, he goes, are mentioned again. Why? It was for all Israel, for a sin offering. It points the way to the day to come in the future where a single sacrifice, a single offering for sin will be made for you and for me and for all who will believe. Well, our hymn of dedication is We Believe, and I'm going to ask our group to come back up because that's the thing we want to get across to everybody. We believe.
Time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe in this
Usher, please come forward for our tithes and offerings, please. Will you please rise? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you give us. Lord, I just ask you to fill these kids with excitement and encouragement and enthusiasm, and I just thank you for their drive. Help us to be the people that we need to be. We thank you for this offering and all of those who give, all the things they give every day here at the church. We just ask you to make us good stewards of all that we have and all that you have given us. Help us to live our lives pleasing to you, to invite others to come to a Bible study and youth groups and Sunday school and church and all the things that go on here. Open our mouths and keep us from being afraid to talk to others and tell others that we believe. We believe. Help us to carry that message all this week. Watch over us and guide us. Be with those at home as well. Keep your hand upon us and each and every person here and those at home, and guide us this week. Keep us safe from all harm. Give us the opportunity to witness to someone, to invite someone to come to church, and just be with us. Watch over our houses and our homes and our financing and our health and all those things we have. We ask all these things. In the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.